If you got in a taxi in New York City between 1997 and 2003, you were greeted with this.
Hi, this is Joan Rivers. Can we talk?
Hello, this is Adam West.
Hi, this is Al Franken.
Hi, Joe Torre here.
Hi, this is Judd Hirsch. You know,
this is Eartha Kitt. Wow.
Celebrities. Their recorded messages reminded you to
fasten your seatbelt.
When you got in a taxi and when you left, they reminded you,
don't forget to take your belongings with you and ask the driver for a seat.
Something reminded me of these recently, and I wanted to hear these messages again, just out of nostalgia. But I was surprised to discover that they weren't archived anywhere on the internet. So, I set out to find them. Along the way, I spoke with many people involved in the program, including Saturday Night Live alum and former senator, Al Franken. I ended up not just with the recordings, but with a definitive oral history of how the program started, stories from its heyday, and ultimately why it ended.
Really what ended up killing the program in many ways was Elmo.
Me? What did Elmo do?
Don't worry, Elmo. We'll get to the bottom of this. To find out how the program started, I spoke with Chris Lynn, the head of the New York City Taxi and Limousine Commission during the Giuliani administration from 1995 to 96.
I began to keep the statistics on lost property. Where does it go? Who catalogs it? What's the procedure if a cab driver finds something in his cab? There was nothing really in place. And as I began to keep these statistics, I noticed we were getting 500 people a month who would leave stuff in cabs. So we need to educate them to take their receipt, because with the receipt, you can find the cab number. How do you do that? Tell the cab driver, remind them, you can't do that, can you? It's tedious. And then it was around Christmas time, and somebody had sent me one of those Christmas cards. You open it up, and there's a microchip that plays 50 Christmas songs. And I just said, I have an epiphany. If they can put a chip in a greeting card, we can put a chip in a taxi meter that says, before you get out of this cab, take your receipt and look around and make sure you take your property. And I did it.
Chris gave the meter companies a script and told them to record the message for the taxi meters, but he didn't tell them who should record the message. So one meter company, Pulsar Technologies, had their secretary do it, a woman named Victoria Drakoulis. She was from Queens, a New Yorker with a thick New York accent. And since Pulsar had more taxi meters and taxis than any other company, her message was heard the most, and people hated it. Here's what it sounded like preserved in a late 90s news story.
And it has one of the modern things that I can't stand.
Please remember to take all of your belongings when leaving this taxi, and please get a receipt from the driver.
Well, you can't win everything. Back to you guys.
She sounded like Fran Drescher from The Nanny. So when it came out, there was all sorts of complaint. The media caught on to it. The New York Times wrote several stories about it.
One woman told The Times, it almost seems to be making fun of New Yorkers. Spy magazine quoted a passenger who called Victoria's voice rough and rather abrasive, not pleasing to the ear at all. The trade publication Taxi Talk dubbed her the Yenta from Hell. A spokesman for the commission got defensive, telling the Times, believe it or not, we didn't put in the audio reminder to annoy people. Pulsar, the company that Victoria worked for, fired her, but she couldn't prove it had anything to do with this mess. Still, some people found her authentic voice endearing, like Rosie O'Donnell, who had her as a guest on her show.
You know what? She did a wonderful job, in my opinion. And she was clear, and it was to the point. I never understood the criticism of that, ever.
But even so, she was soon replaced by a professional voice artist from Pittsburgh who had a boring, neutral voice.
Please remember to take all of your belongings when leaving this taxi and ask the driver for a receipt. Thank you for riding with us.
And that's how things stood when Chris Lynn left the TLC in 1996 and Diane McGrath-McKechnie took over as head of the department. But she soon discovered that she had another problem to deal with. A few years earlier, bulletproof partitions became mandatory in taxis. And now that every taxi had them, they were starting to see partition-related injuries.
In an accident, when your face goes up against a framed plexiglass or bulletproof glass, you're in trouble. You've broken your nose, you may have broken some vertebrae, you've got scars. And some people just don't want to buckle up, and they won't buckle up. And when they get cab face, they're sorry they didn't.
Yep, cab face. That was the industry term for what happens when someone's face smashes into a taxi partition. It was a big enough problem that it was even portrayed in, of all things, The Nanny, in an episode guest starring Rosie O'Donnell.
Red line!
But Cab Face was no joke. The New York Times described terribly debilitating facial injuries, broken cheekbones and jaws, lacerated lips, and discolored eyes. One woman who gashed her face on a taxi partition told the Times, "What really irritates me is the tape. If people want their receipt, they'll get it. Meanwhile, people are bouncing off the partitions and losing their faces. Why not play a tape with safety advice at the beginning of the ride?" Well, Diane was thinking the same thing.
We thought, you know, they're not going to do it just if it's a recording or whatever. Let's put a celebrity on there. And we started seeking out celebrities to do it.
Diane gave the project to her Deputy Commissioner of Public Affairs, Alan Fromberg.
Well, the first challenge, of course, was, you know, where are we getting these celebrities?
So it wasn't the type of job that big celebrities are necessarily looking for.
And then luck stepped in when one internationally acclaimed celebrity found himself in a situation where he needed their help.
He's been called one of the greatest tenors in music history. Plácido Domingo.
Plácido Domingo left his briefcase in a taxi. And in the briefcase was handwritten music, some personal items, which I've sworn never to divulge, some other things that were absolutely precious to him. And they were absolutely necessary for him to go on stage the next night. We were able to actually track it down, and we actually put it in the hands of Mayor Giuliani, who at the time, of course, was the city's number one opera fan.
For he's a jolly good fellow.
And what?
And nobody can deny.
Plácido Domingo, being very, very grateful, the commissioner said, "Hey, we've got this new project. How would you like to be the first voice?" And we were off and running.
Hello. This is Plácido Domingo reminding you to buckle your seatbelt for safety, because you are important. I'll see you at the opera.
With one celebrity down, they set out to find more, eventually landing on seven celebrities to be the first voices of the taxi. They were Plácido Domingo, Joan Rivers, Jackie Mason, Eartha Kitt, Joe Torre, Dr. Ruth, and Judd Hirsch from the TV show Taxi. To write the scripts, Alan drew on his past experience as a writer of a different kind.
Well, back in the 80s, I wrote comic books. I wrote some really silly ones, something called Daffy Gaddafi. I also wrote a script for something called Reagan's Raiders. So I had a little bit of experience writing, but, you know.
Okay, comic books are one kind of writing, but how do you approach writing celebrity scripts for taxi announcements?
I sat down and I tried to come up with the worst puns I possibly could that somehow were specific to them and characters that people would know them for. And that was just the most fun.
Alan went with a small team to record each celebrity, including Ken Podziba, the TLC's chief financial officer, who now found himself doing celebrity outreach.
I remember being in a recording with Joan Rivers, and Joan Rivers is reading the script, and she's going on and on, and she's trying different ones. And finally she goes, "Who wrote this shit?" I said, "Well, he's sitting out there."
She called me in, and she said, you wrote this. I said, yes, ma'am, I wrote this. She said, "It's funny." She said, "And you know what? I always use my own material, but if I didn't, you could write for me anytime." It was a huge highlight for me.
Hi, this is Joan again, reminding you to take your belongings with you, and don't forget your receipt. Could you let me know when we get to Grant's tomb? I have a date with him.
Over the next 6 years, 38 celebrities can be heard in taxis as part of the program. The list includes athletes and fashion designers and comedians and stars of theater and TV and movies. The celebrity talking taxis took on a life beyond New York City in popular culture. The producer of Law & Order, Dick Wolf, included them in an episode of his short-lived NBC series Deadline. And Giuliani himself made fun of them on Saturday Night Live.
What the hell was that?
Celebrities telling people to put their seatbelts on. The mayor put a tape in every cab. Freaking Giuliani!
They even made an appearance on Sesame Street.
Hello, this is Elmo from Sesame Street. Elmo buckles up, and so should you.
Did you say something?
Elmo's not sure.
More on Elmo still to come. So of all the celebrities, which recording session was the most memorable?
That's got to be the Adam West story.
I know Alan Fromberg has his version, but this is what happened with Adam West. It was the Parker Marine Hotel, and it was very noisy. So it was Adam West, I think, said, someone said, let's go in the men's room.
I said, why don't we go into the bathroom? There won't be people. And so we went into the men's room off the lobby, and we recorded a few more versions.
And then Adam West freaked out and said, no, this is too weird. If it ever gets out that we did the men's room, this could like be really weird and creepy, and I don't want people to know that we did it there, whatever. So we go up to his hotel room, which was this big suite. We did it there. And then like a week later, on page 6 that Adam West said we did in the men's room.
Adam West here, back again to remind you to take your belongings and to get a receipt from your driver. I'll see you again. Same bat taxi, same bat time.
Every so often, the celebrity voices would rotate, and the letter in the taxi number would indicate which voice went in which cab. One celebrity used this fact to have a little fun.
Dr. Ruth Westheimer, she knew which were the Dr. Ruth taxis. Every celebrity had, I think, 2 different letters, so she knew the ones that were hers. So she liked to go in her taxis, and the taxi drivers would freak out when they would see her. But she thought that was the funniest thing in the world, that she actually was like in this taxi with her voices in it.
Hello, I'm Dr. Ruth Westheimer with an important message. Please buckle your seatbelt, because safety is very important to me, and so are you.
Most of the recording sessions went well, but Alan Fromberg remembered one recording session that he still had mixed feelings about.
If you could talk to Al Franken, you should ask him if he recalls that his first few draft messages that he pitched were a bit off color. And my government insights couldn't deal with it. So we did revert to the more innocuous script that I wrote for him.
Well, I did talk to Al Franken, and here's what he had to say.
I think I remember. I think I wanted to do, your driver probably doesn't understand what I'm saying, but he thinks you should buckle up. Something on that order. And I thought that if the driver did understand English, they'd find it funny. Which may be wrong, and that if they didn't, there was no harm. But that was me then. It was not only politically incorrect, it was just wrong. It was wrong. I will say that a certain percentage of them would have thought it was funny, and a certain percentage of them would have been saying, like, you drive a cab. You know, you're lucky. You were born here. You had all the advantages of being born here, and I came here, and now I'm driving a cab, and I'm doing this for me and for my family, and, you know, screw you. And that would be completely legitimate. So I'm glad he was there to stop me. So tell him that he made the right call not to... He was completely right to reject that joke.
Well, first of all, the senator looks great. Wow, I'm overcome that he was nice enough to be as frank as he was, or Franken in this case. It's really terrific that he made time to think about this and talk about it. And I appreciate the kind words he said about me.
Hi, this is Al Franken. You know, your driver has to listen to this message hundreds of times a week. The least you can do is buckle up for safety.
Of course, not every celebrity agreed to participate. Some weren't big fans of the administration. Others just weren't interested.
Bette Midler, she was very cordial, but, you know, then you follow up and nothing happens. I wanted Tony Danza for the whole taxi connection.
Actually, Tony Danza, I think, wanted to be paid. And we just didn't have a budget. Dave Letterman was a no. If you want my dream, though, I really wanted Neil Armstrong.
Stand by.
That's one small step for a person and one giant leap for safety. So buckle up.
Or something like that.
And then there were some celebrities who were recorded, but the recordings were never used.
Your viewers will have probably heard of Soupy Sales, maybe. His voice did not lend itself well to the program. There was also a night when we were backstage at the revival of the Sunshine Boys with Tony Randall and of course, Jack Klugman.
The Odd Couple stars reunited on stage despite Klugman's fight with throat cancer that left him with a very raspy voice.
We had a sound engineer with us at the time, and he said, unfortunately, Mr. Klugman's voice is not going to do it. And Tony Randall said, well, if Jack can't do it, I'm not going to do it. And it saddens me that people didn't get to hear his, you know, their message.
And then there's this story about why RuPaul never recorded a message.
I was at a party and I met RuPaul. Someone introduced us and he wanted it to be recording. And I thought it would be great.
This is the beat of New York. This is RuPaul and the new KTU, and we are jamming this morning. It's 6:46.
The next morning, I heard I didn't even know he had a radio show. The whole show was devoted to what he would record. Unfortunately, the administration didn't want him because they thought that RuPaul was too controversial. And I couldn't believe it. Even at the time back then, I didn't think it was controversial, but this administration, I guess, was very conservative and didn't think it was appropriate. Obviously, I didn't tell RuPaul or anybody else until now, but it's been so many years later. I feel like I could tell somebody, but I'm still not over it because RuPaul was so happy about it. And I think New Yorkers would have loved it. And, you know, lighten up, guys. Come on.
Say it with me.
Freaking Giuliani!
So what did cab drivers think of all this? Well, it turns out it's not that easy to find people who were driving taxis in New York City 25 years ago to ask them. But I did manage to track down a couple.
Well, I hated it. It's something else to, like, bombard the cab driver that's not necessary. I was fortunate I got Plácido Domingo and not Elmo or Dr. Ruth. I don't know what the others were, but I don't know what I would have done.
The taxi drivers were not happy. And I think one of the reasons they weren't happy is because it was the same voice over and over and over again. And I remember, I don't know if I read this in the newspaper or it was just common knowledge, but the one they disliked the most was Joan Rivers. They found her voice very grating. So they're like, I'm gonna smash this taxi in a wall. I can't stand this voice. It's driving me crazy.
Ken might be thinking of the driver who told the New York Times, I hate her. I can't stand her. It would be like being nagged by your wife all day. Others didn't like Dr. Ruth. The Daily News reported a cab driver is saying, the one with the Brooklyn accent people could get used to. This one, I don't even understand what she's saying. Another driver told CNN, I have Joe Torre, and I'm a big Yankee fan, but I'm sick and tired of hearing him 60 times a day. But not all the drivers hated it.
It didn't bother me at all. I accepted it, okay? It became routine, you know, and the voice in the back of the car. I like Chris Rock. He introduced me to him, actually. I didn't know who he was.
Hey, this is Chris Rock. He's reminding you to take all your belongings, except that dollar. I hate it. Just kidding. You're in New York City, the millennial capital of the world.
So what about the public? Did people love hearing celebrities in their taxis? And did it work? Did it get people to buckle up and ask for a receipt?
And New Yorkers all said they didn't really like it very much. That I think it was one of those things they loved to hate, though.
One person wrote a letter to the editor of the New York Times addressing the TLC, asking, please, we beg of you, bring back Victoria Drakoulis as the voice of the taxi meter. In various news stories, I found TLC representatives defending the program by talking about how effective it was. But was it?
We actually spoke to the heads of emergency rooms around the city at various hospitals. We basically wanted to see whether or not there was any dip. Unfortunately, there wasn't a lot of quantifiable data there. I don't know to this day how many people it got to buckle up.
Then in August 2001, Mayor Giuliani appointed Matt Doss to be the new chair of the Taxi and Limousine Commission.
One of the few things I was looking forward to when I got appointed chair was doing the program and coming up and collaborating with Alan on different cool things for them to say.
A new set of celebrities had been selected, and some had even been recorded, and Matt was preparing to announce the names to the press, when suddenly, just a few weeks into his new position, came the terrorist attacks of 9/11.
I didn't feel it was appropriate to start announcing new celebrities a couple of months after all these folks died, some of whom I know, and it was a very sad time. So what ended up happening is the usual rotation cycle exceeded the record that we had, and the voices were in there for a long time.
That last set of voices included the Rockettes.
We get a kick out of riding in taxis.
Mary Wilson from the Supremes.
Stop in the name of safety.
Sports announcer Michael Buffer.
So let's get ready to buckle!
And, yes, Elmo.
Elmo's here again. Remember to take your stuff with you and get a receipt. What's a receipt?
Elmo was one of the last voices, I hate to say, and it was fun when it first came out, but after a while it got annoying. So you have all these voices like clicking in the back of your head, and the city's in a tragedy. I kind of felt we needed to do something about it.
In January 2002, Michael Bloomberg replaced Rudy Giuliani as mayor of New York City, and he felt the same way.
The first time I sat down and had lunch with him, he basically, the one thing he pointed out to me over all else is like, what's that stuff in the can with the talky voices? Like, yeah, I'm not crazy about that.
So they conducted a new survey to see what passengers thought, and the results weren't pretty. Two-thirds of the respondents said that they just ignored the messages completely. But what's worse is that 12% of respondents said that when they heard the messages, they refused to buckle up out of spite, because that's how annoying the recordings were. So on February 7th, 2003, in his weekly radio address, Michael Bloomberg announced the end of the program, saying everybody hates the announcements and they will be going away in the very near future.
Probably got the best press of my career. Getting rid of Elmo and pulling him out of a cab at the time. People were like, hallelujah.
It was an over-the-top program, and sometimes it was even a little silly. But the truth is, at its heart, was making sure that people were safe in the back of taxis. And that was what was important, and we did not lose sight of that. And I for one, sure had a lot of fun along the way doing it.
In the end, I was able to get a hold of all but 8 of the celebrity recordings. The only known copy of the 4th group of celebrities is on a corrupt CD that sounds like this. But I will take everything I do have, which includes alternate takes and outtakes that have never been heard before, and I'll upload them to the Internet Archive and put a link to that in the show notes. Also, Al Franken told me an amusing story about the time he left his wallet in a taxi and had his identity stolen by a drug smuggler, but I didn't have time to put that in this video, so I'm going to post that as a bonus clip exclusively on Nebula, and you can learn more information about that in the show notes as well. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time,
wow.